Hi folks, this is David Kwan. So this video I'm continuing to talk more about how I encountered homelessness, how I ended up interacting or witnessing people experiencing homelessness as during my winter break and pretty much right after my winter break. And so my course in Washington, D.C. was from January 4th to January 9th. So it's a week-long course. On January 9th, I took the bus at 7 p.m. or 7:30 p.m., I don't really remember. And it's a five-hour bus ride. I come into New York City. I get into Penn Station. I get into my train heading down to Brooklyn where I live. I have my backpack on and I have my big old suitcase. That was it. That was my luggage. And I have it like in the middle, the center of the pool. I enter and I noticed that the crowd of passengers, you know, there's a lot of people sitting right here. On the other side, so I'm in the middle near the center pole. On the other side, there's like huge space between this one person who's laid out on the seat and these other groups of people just like staying far away from him, but like trying to stay really stuck together because they want to have a seat. They don't want to be standing around, but they don't want to be standing too close to this person sleeping. Obviously a homeless person because he doesn't really have his shoes on. So, you know, I guess I don't know. My sense of smell is gone, so I don't think he's smelly. Maybe that's could explain why they were. But I sometimes think, you know, regular people's kind of like avoidance or they're wanting to keep a big distance away from homeless people has nothing to do with smell. It has everything to do with kind of how our mind thinks of a homeless person, I think. But you know this is not an atypical scene in New York City. You enter the subway trains in New York City. This is unfortunately not an uncommon sight, unfortunately. But it's not like but to be fair, statistically speaking, you know, street homelessness is a tiny segment of New York City's residential population. When we do the count every year of unsheltered people in New York City, the count is about, at this point, about 2,800, 2,700. You know, we could round it up to being about 3,000 people out on the streets in New York City. The New York City has a population of like 8 million people. So 3,000 out of 8 million is kind of the unsheltered population. This is not count. That's not the entire homeless population, but the unsheltered homeless population. So this is a pretty interesting ratio. When we compare this ratio, unsheltered to the total population, it's New York City actually is a pretty remarkable city compared to many other cities in the United States. In Los Angeles, that ratio is god awful. It has less of a its total population is less than New York City. But it has more unsheltered homeless population, striking. So the ratio is in New York City is pretty remarkable. But anyway, that's not the point. When we see a homeless person in the street like that, we're not thinking of statistic ratio. We're not thinking of like, well, this is the we don't think that way. You know, we think emotionally like this is we see a homeless person and we're like, oh my god, you know, I don't want to sit next to this guy. Because we also have very preconceived notions about a homeless person. This person is probably... So, wrong notions, mind you. But this is what we might be thinking in our mind. This person might be crazy. This person might be violent and suicidal. This person, you know, might be, you know, probably going to start asking me and harassing me for money. These are kind of the thoughts that might come into people's head and they kind of just... really try to stay away from this one person. But that's not even the thing about this story. The story gets really. This was a tough one for me because it carries on. So this is about I have about an hour train ride. For some reason that was running super local that day. It was at 1 a.m. So I suppose. New York City subway trains do not operate the way they do. Even when they normally do, it's not a very efficient system. But anyway, So it's running local, it's very slow, it's going to be an hour commute, which I didn't know at the time. I didn't know it was going to be an hour long. But he's sleeping on this, on the seat. And everyone just kind of, it's a very quiet ride at that point. Almost no one really is talking. A lot of them are talking quietly amongst themselves. There's this huge space between this homeless man sleeping and whatever. A few stops we pass, some people get off, some people get on. But there's this huge space. And then the homeless man wakes up. So he's an older gentleman. Like I said, he doesn't have shoes on. He has a cane. He has a jacket. But older gentleman, he wakes up and he sits up. So there's now this huge space between him and the other passengers. So there's not enough passengers so that the people can be sitting down. No one's standing. So there's still a good amount of room in this train at this point. And, I don't want to be kind of like looking at him so much. So I want to give him his kind of privacy and look. So I'm just kind of like looking, it's a very awkward thing to be in the subway. It's just like, where do you look? What do you do? My phone's battery was out, so I can't be looking at my phone. Although I could pretend to be doing that, but that's not my thing. So, I just look down at my suitcase, just kind of wander around. And then, I just kind of, human mind does this, it's just kind of, look back, or glance back, and I just see a glimpse of him. He's freaking crying. Like, he has tears rolling down, and he's just crying. So, that was interesting. It almost made me want to go to him and ask if he was okay, or just start talking to him. Like, there was that compulsion there. I didn't act on the compulsion. I don't know why. Looking back, I don't know. I'm very conflicted on whether I should have or whether I should have not, like I didn't. But I didn't. But I think I found myself frowning and just kind of looking, like it was affecting me because this guy is just crying in his seat. People are looking away, and I didn't want to be like looking away because I didn't want to send a message that I was trying to not think about that, because I was thinking about that. I was thinking about this guy who's crying in his seat with no shoes and with the cane. Just starts crying. And, okay, two stops pass by. He's still just crying. Now people are, no one's getting out, but people are coming in. People are standing. This space between him and the other passengers is getting filled up. This one person, so this is him right here. And this person sits kind of next to him. There's still space right here. But this gentleman who's crying, now he starts moving around. He like kind of just, he moves in a very like a non-traditional way, like non-conventional way. Like, I don't know, like when you see people kind of move around and do things, this is not how people move usually. Not saying that's something wrong with how this guy moves, but it's clearly, other people around the room do not like this at all. They were keeping their space. Now they're forced to not have to keep their space. And he's moving around like this. And he's just like trying to reach into his jacket pocket. And he just takes out like this stack of napkins. Because at one point, I actually was going to dig into my suitcase and give him some toilet paper. Because all I have, I don't have tissues or whatever. But I did have a roll of toilet papers. I was thinking to do that. And as soon as I was like, okay, I'm gonna get in there, as soon as I decided that, that's when he like took out this gigantic stack of napkins. And these are poor quality napkins. These are not great napkins. These are very like super thin, awful napkins. I don't know what you would like. He just has a stack of them. He must have gone to like a restaurant, and that's all he was able to get or something. Clearly, has nothing else on him. Poor guy. But he's very like, I think, he was so emotional because of his sadness, or he has a physical disability, I don't know, but he's moving like this. Normally, if I have a stack of napkins, I was crying, what I would do personally, I would have it in my hand, I'll take one napkin from the top, and I'll probably wipe my eyes with it, right? That's what I would do. I'm not saying, you know, whatever. He just, like that. And he just took the first thing, crumpled it, and just kept doing that. He now has this wad of used napkins with a stack of napkins right here. And he's just doing that. And he's just crying all over the place. And at certain point, like, two stops go by. And he's now, like, he stopped crying. Like, but he's obviously still quite disturbed or sad, whatever. He's still experiencing something. Something in here, in there. I don't know what it is. But he's still experiencing it. Clearly. Very visibly. Everyone is... In some ways, it felt like a very quiet ride. In some ways, it felt like a very loud, talkative ride. My mind is kind of jumbled in that memory. I don't really remember how it was. But now there are more people sitting. Some people are, like, clearly trying to look away. Really not even looking at his direction. But I was, you know, that's the moment when I was repeating in my mind, like, my heart beats with you. I don't know why I do that. Like, it matters. Like, he can't read my mind. It doesn't make sense. Unless I say it to him, he's not going to know that. You know, like, feeling empathy does nothing in that situation. You know, but it was just like, look, I hope you understand that, you know, at least there's me. Maybe there's probably other people in the room. They probably want to talk to you right now, but they, like me, they don't really have the guts or the courage to do so. But it's just here. He's just, you know, and he's just kind of moving around. Now he's just like trying to get this. And right next to him is a pretty bulky man. He's very awkward. He's just kind of his arms crossed. He's not even looking that way. And he's just like this the whole time. And now this this homeless person, I want to give him a fake name. I want to say, let's call him Bill, right? Bill is like trying to put his head on his shoulder and trying to lean on him. And it's almost like a seeking for kind of a human interaction or human engagement. In some ways, it feels like that. And so he's just doing that. And this guy, he's just like a stone. He's just like this, you know. And he's like the guy. He even like puts his legs out. Bill puts his legs out. He tries to do all sorts of things, but he just wants to just kind of remain in that spot where he can lean on someone's head and shoulder. Eventually, he just kind of tries to push him off, but he just fights back. Actually, Bill fights back. He's like, "No, I'm gonna put my head on your shoulder." So that happened until eventually now more people, more stops, more people get in. Now the train is a really crowded place now. And he kind of freaks out. Bill kind of freaks out at one point. He grabs his cane and just slams it down really hard. Everyone gets shocked. Like, what the fuck? And he mumbles something. I can't really understand what he's saying. Because he's he actually, this is a very, very bad thing to do to kind of present this caricature. But he did that. I mean, there are some things that I understood about him. You know, what did he say at one point? But he kind of said something that I actually understood. It wasn't really any, you know, understanding what he said at that moment didn't make me understand why he was feeling what he was feeling. It had no correlation whatsoever. But I didn't understand, like, he, you know, was like, "Oh, this is a long ride" or something. I think he said that. But, yeah, he's got his stick down. Everyone got freaked out because that cane is, he slammed it down so powerfully. He wasn't just a sad man to people. He was dangerous in a way. People felt threatened. So a bunch of people right after that started just trying to walk to the other way, trying to just stay huddled together. Poor people. But they have to stay because all the other train cars are packed to the brim as well. They all want to get home. And these trains are packed because it's running so local that they have to wait 20 or 30 minutes for the next train, right? No one wants to wait 20 or 30 minutes just because of a homeless person. Everyone's just packed in tight. And we're just going like that. A few stops, still packed. One person enters. It's a pretty big, like he's a pretty heavy sized guy, heavy set guy. He enters. He has a newspaper in hand. He's reading the newspaper. Grabs on. He stands like pretty far away from Bill. There's still a big space around Bill, mind you. So that's why everyone is like huddled close together. I still remain at my same place. I'm actually closer to Bill. And you know, I look at him. I make eye contact with him a couple of times. I'm not really able to say anything because what I see from him is so impacting me emotionally as well. Because remember I said I wanted to get into my suitcase and bring out a toilet paper for him, but it's just, I'm just, I don't know what to say. You know, after all this, I've sat and watched through all that, and now I'm gonna like try to talk to him, but it's, anyway, I'm near him, and I'm always thinking like, do I want to start talking to this guy? Do I want to start talking about what do I say? You know, what can I say? Would that be okay? And it's just going through my head, and of course I'm not able to do anything. He stopped crying, so I can't bring a toilet tissue paper. You know, if he has this wad of used napkins, maybe I can, you know, provide him this kind of paper bag that I have to kind of put it away in the trash, but that seems weird and awkward to do. Anyway, this guy with the newspaper walks in. He walks a little past the homeless to Bill, but he's standing right there. Bill kind of freaks out. Bill just like drops his cane, like puts his cane like right near him. He starts yelling at him, like, yo, you. He threw some slurs, which I'm not gonna say it here. You blah 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 blah. He's like, you, this is my space. This is my space. You got all my space. You are in my space, which is weird because there have been some stops where people have been right closer than this guy. But he starts getting super mad, and he starts punching the guy, like, in the shoulder area. But these punches look weak. It's like, it looks like that. It doesn't look like it hurts. But the guy with the newspaper, he doesn't really do anything. He just takes the punches. I was surprised by that, actually. He just takes the punches, and he just kind of walks further into the crowd, being huddled together. And then he's now so far away that that Bill actually has to stand up to hit him. He doesn't bother doing that. He sits back down. He's like, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. And then he just sits back down. And then he's kind of just like that again. I have no idea what that was about. But that happens. And then, you know, one person around me kind of, oh, Jesus, what is this? And she moves right there. And he cusses her out. Like, she's like, fuck you, woman, blah, 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 blah. Cuts her up. Next stop, she gets off, right? And then the next stop, there's this woman, and she has to kind of move there because people are crowding in. And now Bill kind of goes off on her, but not in the really opposite way. It's kind of like sexually harassing, suggestive in a way, like, yo, baby. And he throws her kisses, and he says some things I'm not going to repeat here, which I understood. Like, you know, it was like, I want to blah, 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 blah. She did not understand because she was too far away because he was mumbling, was too low the volume. But I was right there. And, yeah, so he was blowing her kisses. And so the next stop, when there was room available, she's like, oh, no, you know, I totally don't blame her. She didn't feel comfortable. He was not making her feel comfortable at that point. So that she ended up sitting right here, and then she and I actually ended up having a conversation together, and she ended up saying, like, you know, like, I have an uncle who was a Vietnam War veteran, and it was kind of a situation in which we would get him to a hospital, to a shelter, and he would he would be fine in a week, but then the next week he would just kind of, we would visit him in the hospital, and the nurses and doctors say, we don't know where he is. And he took off. So it was always in and out, in and out, in and out. They had to deal with that. So she was saying, you know, I feel really bad for the guy, and talking about that. And we were both talking about, like, how impressed we were with that guy with the newspaper. He just took it. He didn't react. He didn't hit back, which would have been, like, a very, you know, that could have started something. That's not the end of the story, though. Oh my god, this is an hour-long train ride. It felt like 4 hours. And then there's this woman who's been sitting across from Bill the entire time. Totally quiet. She blows up. I don't know what happens as she blows up. But there's such, now, you know how, like, that guy who had a newspaper did not react? She's starting to react. She's starting to yell at Bill. And Bill's like, and she just, like, he picks up his cane and points it at her and slams down the ground. It's so powerful. And the woman reacts. Yeah, yo, motherfucker, you hit the, you want the cane? You gonna hit me with the cane? Yeah, you better hit me with the cane. You wanna know what I can do? Oh, she's riled up, you know, and she's getting close to his face now, and something's about to happen. But, like, the Bill just kind of just like, I don't know what you're doing, whatever, you know. It's just like, they're really close face to face, and he's like, fine, you don't ever do that again. You don't ever do that again. And then she sits down. Bill kind of stays quiet. Next stop. Train open door, now the train is moving again. He picks up his cane and starts pointing at her face. Like, the end of the cane is right close to her face. And she's like, yeah, what, do it again, go, yeah, you hit me. She's egging him on. At the other side of the train, far side of the car, this woman was like, yo, what's going on, man? Like, you better stop that shit. Like, not to the woman, but to Bill. He's like, yo, you guys know each other? He's like, no, we don't know each other. Well, you bet. It's getting, like, reaction, like, kind of a trigger war is kind of happening now. And now the woman and I were like, you know, she's like, you see, people can react to that. And it's like, we're all still huddled together. It's a very crowded, packed train. And I'm thinking, like, only in New York City, man. This is New York City. Like, this is what I've returned to. The minute I step back from Washington, D.C., this is what I'm welcomed into. And it's just, anyway, the woman at the very far end of the car is, you know, it's like, I tell her, it's like, no, they're not related. I'm trying to calm them down. It's like, hey, it's like, all right, fine. So she shuts up and she's about to get close to his face again. And he's like, you know, and she just starts kind of hitting him, but not super hitting him. I could tell that she was restraining herself, but she was done. She was blowing up. She was just like hitting him, you know, like, you know. And Bill, you know, he held his cane, didn't do anything. He just took it, too. And she's like, and then she sat down. The next stop, she got off. And, man, that now train is bustling with conversation now. You know, there's this man trying to talk to Bill. Bill's actually responding in a friendly but angry manner. Like, I don't know what, you know, she tried to beat me up. You know, I got beaten up. You know, I got beaten up real good. And, you know, and this guy right now, like, he gets his phone out and he starts taking pictures of Bill. Like, I don't understand, because he was so amused by the situation. It's just like, I just want to, like, just slam him in her face, but now it's my stop, you know, right when that happens. So I had to get off, but, you know, I actually did make one comment to Bill. You know, like, hey, you know, this whole ride, I made a really quick comment. You know, this whole ride I was with you, you know, I hope it's, seems like you're going through a lot, man. You hang in there, all right, man? You hang in there. And then I walked out. That was so, I don't know, man. That train ride was a roller coaster of emotions for me. It's just, you know, just being so packed with people together like that, and it's just like, I don't know what to have done. My phone's battery was dead. Otherwise, I would have utilized New York City's 311 operating system and tried to refer him. But at that point, he's one of those cases where he's gonna be, you know, if he gets, he's probably going to refuse to go to shelter for the first one. Convincing him to not be in that subway and to go somewhere else is going to be a challenge. And then the outreach team would have a lot of work on their hands. Getting him to a shelter, it might have to be even be involuntary to get him to a shelter or something, you know. But this is the case of he's pretty much a typical case. Not a typical case, but a case of a chronically street homeless, you know. And that was just the encounter. And it was just, I got home and I was just like, wow, I'm here, back in New York City. After my 2 weeks in Iowa, after just a week in Washington, D.C., I am back here where this is. And the woman I was talking to, you know, she said, like, at one point she was saying, see, this is why I'm trying to get out of the city as quick as possible. I'm, you know, my plan is soon, really soon, I'm going to go down in this rural town in Virginia, and I'm going to stay there. It's going to be peaceful. The population over there is 5,000 max, like 5,000 population city. It's going to be peaceful, quiet, none of this. You know, and that's what she was saying. And it was weird because I was feeling like I had an opposite reaction to it. I was in Iowa for a while. I was in D.C. where, you know, I still saw and met with homeless people in both those times. But in New York City was this encounter, this kind of experience, this kind of seeing this kind of thing happen. And I don't know, my reaction was the complete opposite. I was just like, this is why I'm compelled to stay in the city. This is why I want to stay here and be here for a while, you know. Maybe I'll go back to Iowa. Maybe I'll go to some rural southern state or somewhere else, you know, later down the line. Right now, you know, I'm in New York City, and this is what I see. This is what I want to force myself to really deal with and see and witness and to interact with, in some ways. And you know, even with all my kind of social work experiences, which is not that much, and training, which is not that much, and education, which is all, again, not that much. Even with just not that much, I struggle to find the right way of interacting with people who are homeless out on the street. But I think, I try. You know, it's an effort for me to continue trying, and this is the kind of the life I want to lead, is to work. To use the social work training and education I have to serve the homeless. As I said in the first video, that's kind of my specialty now. Social work for the homeless. Still a student, but, you know, after I graduate, that's kind of the area I want to really get into, to interact with them, to let them know that, hey, you know, like, I see you. You're not invisible, and you where you are at is it's a rough place that, you know, there are people like me that's trying, we're not succeeding, but trying to help you. I'll end it on that note, I guess. I don't know where I was going with these stories, but those are that last thing is just like, I don't know, I wanted to talk about it for a while. It's just like, that's after encountering that, it's like, man, that's a story right there, just that on our train ride. I don't really know much about that guy, but I've seen him do that, go through all these kind of different motions. He was sleeping, he was crying, he was trying to find some kind of human contact with that guy sitting next to him. He was angry, he threw his cane down on the floor, he let out kind of sexual frustration or sexual urges toward that woman. I can just see on the outside, it's like so many ranges of emotion, just that 1 hour train ride, you know? And it's just a tiny, tiny window into what his life is like. Yeah. Anyway, that's all I have to say on this. If you've been watching through this, it's been 28 minutes. It's a freaking long video, but thanks for watching. And I always say, when I see that, I repeat in my head, my heart beats with you, for whatever that means.